Turing talked about childlike imagination as a key to creative genius, let's turn to the prodigy and contrast the prodigy with the genius. What's a prodigy? Well, broadly speaking, the word prodigy denotes an amazing or marvelous thing, something out of the ordinary course of nature. A prodigy, thus, is not necessarily tied to youth. A 300-year-old tortoise on the Galapagos Islands is a prodigy of nature, as is a 4,000-year-old California sequoia. But today, a prodigy is generally understood to be a young person possessing talents far beyond their years, a young person with the facility of a mature adult. Picasso could draw at the age of 3. John Stuart Mill wrote a history of Rome at the age of 6 in Latin. And Bill Gates, who on a math test of 8th to 12th graders in Washington State got the highest score as an 8th grader. To us, such talent is inexplicable. For the moment, we'll call it just plain genius. And that's how contemporary culture views it. Watch the television show Child Genius, which premiered on the Lifetime Network in 2015. Here we see children up to the age of 12 compete for the title Child Genius of the Year. The contestants are said to have IQs that range from 140 to 158, display extraordinary feats of memory and calculation. The winner takes home $100,000. Let's watch a video clip.
4, 6, 2, 6, 4, 3, 8, 3, 2, 7, 8, 5, 4, 2, 8.
People remember number one. They don't remember number two.
Time to study for math.
What does philanthropy mean?
Philanthropy means like goodwill and like really helping out mankind.
Drink some water before you start the prom.
Okay.
The first two rounds are math and geography.
I'm gonna pull up another one.
That's Hurricane Camille.
Do you know what year this was?
1969. It has sustained wind speeds of 190 miles per hour and at a minimum pressure of 905 millibars.
Studying for this competition, it's like a huge family effort.
361 plus 261.
622.
Our school is 2 or 3 grades ahead in math. I finished Algebra 1 for 6th grade, and normal people finish that for 9th grade.
More recently, NBC has tried to satisfy our appetite for prodigies with the series Genius Junior. In TV game shows, genius and youth are synonymous. Instead of individuals, here teams of 3 preteens compete for $400,000. Why children are playing for money is beyond me, but let's watch a video clip.
Pairing these two grids, which space is different?
D3.
Correct. What is the sum of the following green numbers?
179?
Incorrect, 176. What word consecutively uses all of the following letters?
Diatribe.
Correct. How many squares appear in the image below?
10.
Correct, hit the brain. Sebastian, what comes next in this sequence?
C.
Correct, unscramble the word below.
Pass.
Longitudinal. How many diamonds are needed to balance the bottom scale?
7.
Correct. Memorize this image. What were the first number and fourth letter?
2. R.
Correct. Add the following 3 numbers together.
8, 9, 1.
Yes, hit the brain. Apoorva, when comparing these two grids, which space is the same?
C4.
Correct. How many triangles appear in the image below? 10 seconds.
Pass.
8. What is the sum of the following yellow numbers?
173.
Correct. Just in the nick of time. Well done, you guys. Come on down. Wow. That was fantastic. That's a harder cortex than the preliminary rounds, huh?
But as with child genius, here on Genius Junior, exceptional performance is measured by math skills as well as memory for geographical places and correct spelling, sometimes backwards. The ability of the young contestants on both programs are hugely impressive, but their expertise is limited to certain fields, those involving quantification and memory of letters and words and numbers, that sort of thing. Skills that can be immediately validated in the form of a correct answer. In fact, prodigies generally first manifest in such formal, rule-governed domains as chess, math, music, and mnemonic processing. But are the contestants on Child Genius and Genius Junior, as the name genius suggests, really geniuses at all? No, they are not, I would submit. They're simply prodigies. So what's the difference between prodigy and genius? Prodigies demonstrate great facility at an early age. Geniuses, however, create. They change the world through original thinking that impacts the actions and the values of society. Prodigies merely mimic. They do not stand at the avant-garde of their field and change its direction. Although these children are precocious, from the Latin praecox, a fruit ripe before its time, they come with an expiration date. If they have not begun to create, develop an original creative voice by the age of, say, 17 or 18, they may never do so. What about the three geniuses we showcased in our last segment, Mozart, Picasso, and Einstein? Were they prodigies? Well, Mozart certainly was. Here's the little man at age 6 in a suit given him by Empress Maria Theresa. Even in his day, Mozart was called both a genius and prodigy of nature. He had the natural gifts and facilities of a prodigy. What were they? Well, Mozart was born with perfect pitch, also born with an extraordinary phonographic memory, memory for sounds, as well as a motographic memory, meaning that he could instantly move his hands to the right place or key on the violin, organ, or piano. These are the talents of a hugely gifted prodigy. And for that reason, Mozart was called on to perform, to show off his talents, traveling to the ruling courts of Austria, France, and England, when he was age 6 to 8. In this painting, we see him in Vienna, but Mozart could also create at an early age. Mozart was one of those very, very few people who was both a prodigy and a genius. Again, prodigies mimic, geniuses create. Let's listen to a symphony that Mozart composed at age 8. Is this symphony a masterpiece? I don't think so. At the beginning, it's somewhat repetitive, but it's pretty darn good for an 8-year-old. But now a piece that is a masterpiece by Mozart, the Waisenhaus Messe, Mass for the Orphanage, that the Empress, again Maria Theresa, commissioned from him when he was 12. we'll hear just a snippet of the glorious section of that Mass. Influential masterpiece. Others came to copy this style of church writing by a 12-year-old. Pablo Picasso was a prodigy too. Family members said that he could draw before he could talk. The first word he uttered was apparently pitz, his baby word for lapis, pencil. When he wanted something, he would simply draw it. Just as Mozart could go instantly from a note he had in his ear to the correct spot on a piano keyboard, so Picasso had eye-to-hand duplicative ability. He could see and immediately draw what he saw. It's the natural gift of a prodigy. By his early teens, prodigy Picasso was a better painter than most adult masters of the day, as we see by this portrait of his mother and his painting, Picasso's painting, First Communion, both done at age 15. In a sense, however, Picasso's style here is traditional and conventional. Great facility, but where's the creativity? For me, what has always been the most impressive early painting of Picasso, a work of true originality, a work of true genius, in my opinion, is his The Old Fisherman, done when Picasso was just, get this, 14. A portrait that shows remarkable empathy for the subject and remarkable psychological introspection. Here we are allowed to look not only on the face, but also inside the soul of a tired, world-weary man. What about Einstein? Well, here opinion varies. Some say Einstein failed math, but others say that he was a prodigy. To settle the issue, I'm going to again call on my friend and colleague at Yale, Professor Douglas Stone, author of the book Einstein and the Quantum, to give us what is surely the definitive opinion.
And he showed great aptitude for math at a young age. So there is a urban legend that he failed math, that at least in the for many years propagated. Maybe you didn't hear this. And, you know, if your kid wasn't doing well at math, we'd just say, well, don't worry, Einstein failed math. Well, that turns out not to be true. He was very good at math, but he wasn't a prodigy. I mean, he wasn't a prodigy like Gauss, who at age 6 was deriving fundamental new things. Okay, he was just really smart.
Okay, Einstein didn't fail math. He was just very, very good at both math and physics, but he was no prodigy. As to modern geniuses, consider the aforementioned Elon Musk, Jeff Bezos, and Bill Gates. Musk seems to have been thought of by his teachers and certainly by his parents as a prodigy. Bezos was in programs for gifted children when growing up in Texas. And Gates, as mentioned, was a math and computer whiz. When Gates's high school needed a new class scheduling system, they didn't turn to outside consultants. They just hired their own high school junior, Bill Gates. These three geniuses were prodigies. Thus, prodigies must grow into geniuses, right? No, far from it. For every prodigy who morphs into a genius, there are thousands who don't. We don't ever hear of those who don't because they make no impact. They simply disappear from public consciousness. That's a subject to which we'll return later. But now an important question, one, alas, for which there is again no definitive answer. Occasionally, a gifted prodigy, such as a Mozart or Picasso, not only possesses great technical facility, but also comes to possess the distinctive creative vision of the genius. How does that happen? There are a myriad of possibilities. One explanation, speaking in terms of physiology, may have to do with neural pruning. Neural pruning that occurs naturally in the brain in late adolescence, the time that the brain is most complexly wired, and the person perhaps most emotional and rebellious. Is it some sort of neural overwiring, neural pruning that doesn't occur, that allows a few rare cases in the age group, say 18 to 23, to see the world differently? That's one theory. In this regard, I keep asking myself, why is it that the truly transformative pop music that has been created in the last half century has been fashioned by people around 20 or in their 20s? And why, after their 20s, does their creative vision seem to diminish? Why do they seem to lose the magic, lose custody of their inner child, to borrow again from Kanye West? We might think here of Nobel Prize singer Bob Dylan, who has now turned 80, but he wrote his best songs by far in his 20s. We might also think of the extraordinary creativity of the Beatles, maybe the freshest and most original musical sound of the 20th century, certainly in pop music. For me, although I know that I'll get opposition here, and rightly so perhaps, for me, the driving force behind the creativity of the Beatles was Paul McCartney. Youthful McCartney and the Beatles were the idols of American singer-songwriter James Taylor, who recorded his first album in 1968 in the same Abbey Road studio in which the Beatles recorded some of their transformative albums. How did 20-year-old American James Taylor gather the hubris to make it to London and into this famous studio to do such a thing? As Taylor said in 2021, quote, "I had some competence and the arrogance of youth. If we didn't have those things, nobody would ever do anything because you would hedge your bets. There's a stage in our development where you're allowed to do the impossible, impossible things." That was supremely arrogant and destined to fail, but it did actually change a lot, end quote. The Beatles and McCartney and Taylor changed a lot about pop music during the 1960s. The Beatles had 20 number one tunes. They were not only part of the culture, but they created a unique culture in the 60s. But if you are a young genius with the capacity to hit a target like no one else can see, that may not last forever. Maybe you can no longer see the target because somebody else, society, has moved the target. You keep shooting your same arrow at the same spot in the same way with your art, but now you miss. Maybe other young geniuses in their 20s come along with a new target or a new way of connecting with society. First the Bee Gees, perhaps with disco, and then Jay-Z, and then Lady Gaga with hip-hop, and later Kanye West and Kendrick Lamar with rap. Your number one tunes gradually become number 50 tunes at best. In his 20s, genius McCartney had jumped outside the box. But then, over time, he became the box. He became the tradition against which others, with new sensibilities, rebelled. Anyway, what causes an original creative voice to develop? Adolescent arrogance, as James Taylor suggested? Neural pruning? And late adolescent rebellion? Well, I'll suggest something else in a moment. But for now, let's move on to the flip side of the prodigy genius issue, that of non-prodigy late bloomers. As suggested, most prodigies don't become geniuses, and similarly, most geniuses never were prodigies to begin with. prodigies seem to appear only in a few areas, in math, music, chess, spelling bees, for example. Geniuses seem to appear in many fields and often in ways that can't be anticipated. What genius transformed the world the most at the youngest age? Many would argue Isaac Newton, perhaps the West's greatest scientist, as we have seen. In 1665, when Newton was 23, the bubonic plague ravaged England, much as the COVID virus ravaged the world in 2020, 2022. Cambridge University, where Newton was then a student, shut down, and he went back home to the farm village of Woolsthorpe, where he quarantined. For the next year, during a period of intense concentration, Newton laid out the essentials, the details would follow, of four revolutionary discoveries: integral and differential calculus, a theory of color spectrum, gravity, which required him to then set out the fourth of these, and finally, his laws of motion. What genius transformed the world the most at the oldest age? Well, again, that leads to pure speculation, based on what one means by transformed the world the most. Search on the internet for world's oldest genius, and nothing relevant comes up. Let me suggest some possibilities, and notice they work in fields such as the arts and humanities and observational sciences, and not in pure math and physics. Vincent van Gogh, well, he didn't start to paint with oil until he was 29. Paul Cézanne did not have any of his works accepted by the official Salon in Paris until he was 43. Grandma Moses, well, the name speaks for itself. She didn't start to paint until she was 76. Beethoven was 30 when he published his first symphony. Gandhi didn't return to India to lead an independence movement until he was 46. Shakespeare wrote his greatest plays between the age of 36 and 47. Toni Morrison didn't publish her first novel until she was 39. Darwin didn't release his bombshell on the Origin of Species until he was 50. Composer Verdi was such a non-prodigy that he wasn't even accepted to the Music Conservatory in Milan when he applied. He completed his famous operas Aida at age 57 and Falstaff when he was 80. Ben Franklin signed off on the U.S. Constitution when he was 81. Richard Strauss composed some of the most beautiful music any human has ever created. His last four songs when he was 84 years old. So, if you weren't a child prodigy, don't despair. There is still time to become a genius. Perhaps to encourage us all, we'll end this lesson by fading out with the glorious, glorious sounds of 84-year-old Richard Strauss. Enjoy.